My name is Joe Rowe. I'm currently at the University of Copenhagen. This presentation is mostly drawn from my PhD research, which I did at the Institute of Archaeology in London. I am British, so I will pop this out with an apology if it's a bit unfocused. The genesis of this presentation really was a meeting I had with my supervisor right at the beginning of my PhD. And at that time, when I'd signed up to do it, I really saw it as a GIS project, quote. So I was asking him, you know, which piece of software do you think I should use? Should I go open source with QGIS or, God forbid, to use ArcGIS? But he said, my supervisor, Andy Bevan, he said, the spatial tools in R are actually getting quite good. Why don't you just try and use that for everything? So I thought, that's an interesting idea. I'd used R a little bit before for statistics, but never really thought about its applications beyond that. And I probably took him a little more literally than he intended. And sort of since that point, it's been a kind of personal challenge to do absolutely everything I do in R. And so with this presentation, I want to just kind of summarize the results of that experiment of using R as a GIS, but also for modeling, for other types of analysis, and for even writing up at the end. I'll start by going over a quick rundown of the structure. You know, how do you structure a fairly large piece of research in R? We'll quickly go through some of the specific applications that I've employed and how well that went. But as the title of the talk suggests, I thought that since we've already heard a lot of talks about how good R is, and I think, you know, we probably all agree that R is a good tool, I'll focus a bit more on highlighting the barriers and the limitations that I found myself pushing up against, and maybe highlight some areas where R is, at least its current state, maybe not the best tool, maybe something that should be used in conjunction with something else. So to begin with just the structure of an R piece of research, I wasn't too familiar when I started with it, so I went through lots of different paradigms of structuring my code. The one I eventually came up with after a lot of dead ends and reinventing the wheel is by no means original. It's a now familiar idea of structuring a discrete piece of research as a discrete R package. And so this is something that Ben Marek talks about a lot. You might also call it a research compendium, a slightly different angle on it. But the idea is, if you start with the sort of neat and simplified model of doing a PhD, you start by getting some data, easy, right? You develop a methodology, you do your analysis, you write up, and you submit. Simple. And this does, these stages do map nicely onto the standard structure of an R package. So if you conceptualize the whole thing as a package, all your data can simply be stored in a data directory, which a lot of packages do have. Your methodology gets implemented as R scripts in another subdirectory. If you're sticking with a strict package model, the nature of the scripts here are important. They should be essentially libraries of objects and functions. No code should be actually run here, otherwise it will be evaluated when you include the package. And you'd want to try and structure it as sort of one script to one discrete type of analysis, so it's something that hopefully you and other people can reuse. But of course, that does leave what do you do with the interactive analysis that you do need to do. It's not really practical to do everything in the console or using a Markdown document. So I'm not sure of the best way to do that, but what I do is I've hijacked the tests directory, which is really intended for unit tests for the integrity of your code. But it works well because it's not usually evaluated. And so what you can do is stick little bits of sort of working code analyses that you might want to repeat over and over again in that test directory. Of course, Hadley Wickham has a package that redoes the whole thing in a much better way, so you can use his test that package to structure it into a nice, neat code box. Like I say, I'm really not sure if that is the most R-ish. You know, there's this word, if you do Python, they say that things are Pythonic. I'd always wondered what the word for R is. It's R-ish or R-y, I don't know. So if anyone knows a more R-ish way of doing it, I'd be interested in knowing. But your formal, final analyses are better structured as vignettes. And I imagine this is something most people who use R will be familiar with. They're usually used in the documentation of packages. But more generally speaking, they're just as implementation of literate programming. So the concept that you embed code directly into a narrative explanation of what you're doing. And the traditional way of doing vignettes in R is to use LaTeX and Sweave, which is a base R function for embedding R in LaTeX documents. I still think probably LaTeX is the way to go with something as complex as a PhD. It's a large document, and LaTeX is the standard anyway. But you can use the more modern Knitter package to get slightly better embedding of code than you would with Sweave. And you could also use this newfangled R Markdown to write chapters as well. So in theory, if you do structure a project like this, a PhD or a Master's or any other piece of research, you've got several advantages. One, you can run all the analysis from scratch, from data collection or whatever your starting point is, to generating a submission-ready document just by building the package. It should all happen automatically, in theory. You will fulfill your reproducible research obligation with a nice simple shell command, all done. And you've already got all your code neatly modularized, so it's easy to distribute, easy to reuse in other projects. Maybe not as passing around a package that also generates your paper, but you can just copy them out and put them in a more distributable package fairly easily. Unfortunately, I have to admit, I can't claim to have reached that point of elegant neatness myself, but in theory, that's what I'm aiming towards. So that's a whistle-stop tour of my package structure. Like I say, I don't think it's original by any means, but that's what I eventually stumbled on. What I actually did with it quickly, my topic was about the human ecology of the Epipaleolithic of Southwest Asia. So the idea was to do a sort of layered multi-model reconstruction that would go from the physical geography of the area and layer on top of that models of animal behavior and human behavior. So as a result of this kind of broad rather than narrow research focus, I needed to do a lot of sort of different bits of analysis from lots of different fields rather than one particular thing. And as I said, I challenged myself to do it all in R. Unfortunately, R being the Swiss Army knife that it is, I never came across anything that I couldn't do at all. So the particular workhorses I found were Roger Bivens' family of spatial packages. So SP is the base, but there are a half a dozen packages that elaborate on that. Although I have learned this week, I think that they're moving from SP to SF, which is based on simple features, maybe be a bit better. And so on top of that, there's the Raster and Spatstat packages, both really good. They handle raster and point pattern, spatial analyses, respectively. And with the combination of those packages, you really do have a full-featured GIS right there in the R environment. Of course, also a major workhorse would be Hadley Wickham, the Hadleyverse, the ggplot and related packages. I think they take as existing excellent capability for exploratory analysis. I think that's what he really excels at, and just takes it up another notch. That's very important. But I also found that even doing very niche things like hydrological modelling, I could do with the Hydromad package, which is very sophisticated. Species distribution modelling with MaxEnt, or the more new Dismo package. There's also a very nice framework for agent-based modelling hidden away in the SIM-ECOL package, which I don't think is very well known in the world of archaeology at ABMs. It is very well designed. And also Base-R is quite good at agent-based modelling to begin with. And also, just to note, the packages that I've underlined are my own packages that I will hopefully one day get around to publishing. So R is great. I did all these things in R, and it was generally a very good and successful experience. But like I say, I don't want to waste too much time preaching to the converted. So what were the problems that I came across? There are lots of limitations with R, like any piece of software, and it will depend on your application. But the three categories of limitation I find myself bumping up against quite often is, in terms of technical things, are memory limitations, which is inherent to R being a very high-level interpreted language. There's interactivity. I mean, R is interactive to an extent. It has a console. But I think comparing a scripted environment to a GUI, you are always going to lose interactivity. And the third limitation I often came up against was the learning curve and the difficulty of encouraging the use of R in people other than myself who really like it. So to quickly go over the memory problems, these are the words that often haunt my dreams. Very basically, memory in R is handled quite crudely. Almost all objects are stored in memory rather than on disk at all times, and that can very quickly become a problem even with simple numerical analyses. When you're constantly duplicating objects. It is a particular problem if you're using R as a GIS, because if you're doing raster analysis, rasters are already pretty big to begin with, so one slide of the analysis I produced on the right is 160 megabytes as a raw file. If you take that into R as a base object, or as the SP's very well-named spatial grid data frame, it doubles the memory footprint just with a single slide. The animation on the left is about 150 slides, frames I should say. One promising avenue is you can use a raster package to theoretically reduce this to zero, because it stores them on disk. But the problem is all the other analyses that you would build on top of raster using other R tools or base R will inevitably at some point want to take it all into memory, and you're just sort of delaying those dreaded words. So one solution to that problem is simply to go for more memory. Buy memory. I bought some more RAM recently, and it made my life a lot easier. Or you can use cloud computing. I have to speed up a bit, but you can use cloud computing to run it elsewhere. To plug my blog, I wrote a quick tutorial on how you can set up RStudio server, which is a very excellent, well-featured version of RStudio that runs in a browser on a Google Cloud Compute instance. And you can knock the memory up on that up to 624 gigabytes of RAM. So that makes you feel very good for winning the arms race against our poor memory management. And it's not too expensive, it'll cost you a few euros for a few hours. Or you can outsource the models, the algorithms that you're doing to better optimized programs like GRASS, or if you are a glutton for punishment, you could implement this as C and then embed that as binaries within your R package. It's essentially what I ended up doing, but again, if anyone knows a more elegant way, I think that's not a very good long-term solution. The more long-term solution would probably be improving our ability to deal with these things.
Did it with Azure computer, platform computer systems?
Sorry?
You try to outsource?
Well, I mean outsource in the sense to other tools. So here I use the GRASS command line to do the analysis instead of that. It's a lot better. So I apologize, I've timed this badly, but I will quickly run through. My other gripes were, you know, interactivity. If you use a real GIS, you can very easily explore maps, explore spaces. In R, you can produce very beautiful publication-ready maps, but they're static and it's quite fiddly to do exploratory analysis in them. One solution to that is to use R through the GIS, so QGIS specifically will let you call R scripts from within its GUI. I'll skip over that, I'm afraid. And luckily, the final bit is something we really covered in the discussion earlier. So rather than duplicate that, it's just to say, yes, I do think we have this great reproducible ideal that we can all aim for as computational specialists, but the reality of archaeological research is often, you know, there's quite a gulf there. And I think we need to think about how can we meet in the middle between the capabilities of your average collaborator and your capabilities as a computational specialist. And there might be things like building shiny apps, using GUIs for R, working on WYSIWYG editors for R Markdown, things like that. To conclude, R is great, I do like it, but I think if we're going to keep advancing it in the field, we have to be realistic about where its limitations are and how we can overcome them. Thank you.